Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, Strategies for Surviving Year-End Reporting. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our first speaker and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. And I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have a couple more slides at the end to serve as instruction on how to access your certification. And lastly, before I introduce our first speaker for the day, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has nearly 60,000 employees and over 700,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce the first of today's speakers, Pete Iceberg. Pete is Vice President of ADP Government Relations and brings over 30 years of experience working with state legislatures and Congress, as well as the IRS and state agencies in workforce development, child support enforcement, and municipal tax authorities concerning employment tax administration, withholding, and information reporting issues. With that, Pete, I know you and the team have a lot of content you'd like to cover, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
All right. Thanks, Karen, and welcome all to year-end 2019 and into the new year, which is right around the corner. Next year includes some pretty fundamental changes to payroll and tax administration, so there's a lot to go over. I'll start with the IRS Form W-4 and changes to federal and state withholding, but we also have a very strong and noteworthy lineup to talk to us about their respective areas of expertise. So on unemployment insurance, we'll hear from a former deputy director of unemployment insurance tax for the state of Maryland, who was also the UI tax chief for the U.S. Department of Labor. On federal and state year-end reporting changes, we'll hear from a former IRS official with 23 years of experience with IRS on employment tax matters, and from a former director for the North Carolina Department of Revenue. I'll close with some comments on emerging state mandates related to the Affordable Care Act that looks like it's going to affect employers in the next couple of years. But before we get into the tax reform piece, I believe we have a polling question to start. Karen?
Thank you so much, Pete. Yes, and we have our first question of the session. And our first question is, how are you primarily staying informed of tax reform changes? Obviously, you use a lot of different methods, but what tends to be your primary go-to for this? And possible responses are newsletter, trade associations, service providers, broker, CPA partners, legal counsel, or other. And I'll give you all several seconds to respond and give my first CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to give you all about five more seconds. All Okay, Pete, you should be seeing the results on the screen.
I do. Looks like it's mostly newsletters, trade associations, which is, I guess, and service providers, which is consistent with, I guess, what we understood. Really, it's an all-of-the-above kind of exercise in my mind. There's a lot to keep up with and many different sources to help us with that. All right, so jumping into the Form W-4, this is sort of just a quick at-a-glance, 2019 versus 2020. Major changes, a lot of information removed from the 2019, a lot of additional information added to 2020. The biggest change is that there's no withholding allowances, which is going to raise some questions next year. Allowances have been the basis for payroll withholding forever. And this new form could be daunting to some employees. It's longer, it's more detailed, but when you get into it, it's really much, much easier for employees. So I'll explain that as we go through this. In terms of just highlights, I mentioned the no withholding allowances, the new filing status, head of household, significant change. That does mean, additional tax tables and tax calculations related to that new head of household status. Existing employees do not have to complete the 2020 version. So that's a very key point. It means that employers can expect to support the prior W-4 and the prior withholding allowance regime pretty much forever for the foreseeable future. So if existing employees are happy with their current withholding, they can just leave it alone. They can leave their 2019 or prior Form W-4 in effect, and employers should plan to maintain essentially two payroll systems, one based on the old allowances system and a new payroll system with the new 2020 W-4 inputs. After 2019, new hires have to use the 2020 Form W-4. And in fact, all employees will need to use the 2020 version if they want to adjust their withholding. So on this point, question, what is the employer's obligation? If an employee comes to you and says, look, I just want to change my withholding allowances from 5 to 4, I really don't want to mess with the new form, can you do that? Generally, the answer is no. Generally, the answer is the only valid Form W-4 after 2019 is the 2020 version. However, I'll mention this, there may be circumstances where you might want to make an exception, so it's not a super hard rule. Lastly, for new hires that don't complete a Form W-4 after 2019, you should treat them as single with no adjustments, similar to last year's single zero allowances treatment. So a quick, comparison again at a glance, here's what's changed. In 2019, there were really only two inputs beyond the marital status. There was withholding allowances and additional per pay amount to withhold, and those were really the two levers that you had to adjust your withholding previously. It's very simple for employers, but actually when you get into it, it's very tough for employees. In 2020, there are several new inputs to payroll withholding. There's a new checkbox for multiple jobs and two earner families, otherwise known as optional hire withholding, except they don't call it that anymore. It's optional hire withholding. It used to be called that in earlier versions, and it is effectively optional hire withholding. It's just now carefully called the box in step 2 of Form W-4. But this new checkbox actually is probably the most important change and the most novel and bold change on the part of Treasury and IRS. It really addresses the crux of the problem of tax withholding, which is that tax liability is based on family income, and yet employers only know the income of one spouse, so how can you possibly get withholding right? Previously, there was a 9-step worksheet with table lookups. It was quite tough, and employees calculated an additional amount to withhold. In contrast, this new checkbox is wonderfully simple. If you can boil down this complex problem down to a checkbox, it's really a major improvement for taxpayers. And essentially, the way it works is the tax tables will assume that spouses earn about the same amount, and it divides the standard deduction and tax brackets equally between two jobs. So, for example, for somebody with married filing jointly, the 24% tax rate normally applies to wages over about $180,000. But if that step 2 box is checked, the 24% rate will apply to wages over about $96,000. Hope that makes sense. Other new payroll inputs include full-year child independent tax credits, full-year other income, and full-year deductions. So it's pretty straightforward, just, what are your estimated other income deductions, and just write that down, and the employer will pick it up from there. The additional amount to withhold is pretty much the only thing that didn't change from last year to this. And briefly, this has some implications for new hire onboarding. So how does that change how you handle new hires? Today, perhaps you offer these new hires a handful of forms to fill out on their first day of work, like the I-9, Form W-4, direct deposit authorization, things like that. Now, employees may need more time to complete the W-4. They may actually need a private room to call their accountant or their spouse, at least, to look up last year's return, or a family member that understands taxes pretty well. Remember, previously, the Form W-4 was a 30-second exercise, really. Just jot down your name, address, social security number, allowances, signatures, you know, counting family members, essentially. Very quick. Now, you know, you have to remember what did I claim to the IRS for my total deductions last year? You know, do we even qualify for child tax credits this year? What about dependent tax credits? What was our total other income? I mean, how many of you remember all those details? So not off the top of your head, probably. Anyway, if new hires complete the Form W-4 in the office as part of onboarding, you may want to consider offering it as something that they could take home to complete. Or, you know, as I said, provide a private room for them to fill this out and permit them to call home for details and so forth. The good news is only steps 1 and 5 are required, and that's just the name, address, filing status, and signature. So for somebody with standard deductions, no dependents, no other income, it's still a 30-second exercise. It's pretty quick. I want to mention also that, you know, employers should be familiar with the one alternative, which is the new IRS withholding estimator. This alternative is one way that people with multiple jobs or complex tax situations or spouses that work can come up with the right withholding adjustments for the year. It's a question-answer format which gathers relevant information. And importantly, you can use this anytime during the year to check and see if your current withholding is on track and avoid any, you know, unpleasant surprises at the end of the year. So try this yourself if you get a chance. One helpful point is that the system can specify, you can actually begin using the system by specifying your desired refund amount. For example, you know, zero, that's really what you want to get to, is let's not owe them anything and let's not get a refund at all. Would be a best case outcome. But you, if you like a $2,000 or $5,000 refund, you can actually specify that going in and it'll tell you exactly how to get there. The only cons is it takes some time to gather records. I mean, I went through this in about 10 minutes, but of course I cheated and I guessed at the amounts from last year's Form 1040. So gathering up, you know, last year's tax return may take some time, that kind of thing. This is pretty helpful for those, you know, people with major changes, life changes, such as a marriage, a job change, a new house, a new child, that kind of thing. So it's easy to find. Just go to irs.gov and search for withholding estimator. But this is a good good thing to know about for those questions that you'll be getting from employees. Otherwise, I wanted to switch gears and ask, you know, how has states responded? And we're a little bit concerned about a number of states that still have allowances in their tax systems. They're still in, you know, use allowances in the withholding tax tables, and they rely exclusively on the IRS Form W-4. Obviously, the 2020 IRS Form W-4 has no space for allowances, so they have to do something. They can either issue a W-4 equivalent for the state, or they can adopt the IRS inputs and change their tax calculations. We actually sent letters to every state tax commissioner that is in this situation, and we got some responses to the effect that they are still considering both options. We did hear from Nebraska, for example, that said that they would issue a state-specific W-4 equivalent with allowances, but otherwise I think the jury is still out. But, you know, if a state adopts the new IRS Form W-4 inputs late in 2019, it could be a pretty major change to employers to, you know, to accommodate new tax tables, new calculations. For example, does the state tax system observe the head of household status? If so, is that going to require a separate withholding table? Would they observe the optional higher withholding checkbox? And if so, does that require two withholding tables per marital status? So potentially a lot of work associated with that. All this would be quite difficult to implement by January, so obviously stay tuned. And I already went through all this. Part two, what I want to mention is that there's an effort to respond somehow to the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act limitation on deductibility of state taxes, which is $10,000. There have been a number of proposals, but one that we're tracking is that states could broadly shift and de-emphasize from income taxes over, you know, since they're now largely non-deductible, over to payroll taxes, which would remain fully deductible. This would literally shift the tax burden to employers, but there are design options that would make employers whole in such a change. We don't have time to get into these today, but there are details in the appendix, which you can download after the webinar. And just, you know, to summarize in a couple points of what to watch for, again, the 2020 IRS Form W-4 change is going to cause some confusion. You can expect a lot of questions from employees in early 2020. Certainly watch for late state tax changes related to the IRS Form W-4. And look for New York, Connecticut, and other states to consider significant tax changes to shift to an employer payroll tax. Lastly, and I didn't talk about this much, but there could be a significant year-end tax bill in Congress in late 2019 that could affect 2020 withholding. We're certainly going to be carefully attuned to that. So I think with that, I will turn it over to Tom Crowley on unemployment insurance.
Thank you, Pete. That was some great information. Thanks to everyone. Good morning, and welcome to our presentation. Just to give you a little background on my career. I've been with ADP almost 5 years now, and as Pete alluded to earlier, I have some experience at the national level with the Department of Labor as unemployment insurance tax chief, and then career in state government for 30 years with also with unemployment insurance tax. So there's some experience there for all three levels at state, federal, and private experience with unemployment tax, and currently function as director of government affairs with unemployment insurance is my focus. So let's talk now about unemployment insurance, both at the federal and the state level. We'll start off with a brief discussion of the FUTA tax. The slide here is a 940 credit certification, and this, unless you have employment in the U.S. Virgin Islands, there will not be any FUTA credit reductions for FUTA year 2019. On the next slide, we'll look at circumstances that could still lead to higher FUTA taxes. But the good news is that the recovery has had a positive effect on FUTA, and there have not been any reductions. Even when there are no credit reductions due to federal trust fund loans, borrowing, employers could still have higher FUTA taxes because they fail to qualify for the full 5.4% credit. And the things that would lead to that condition would be them employers not paying state unemployment insurance taxes by the due date, which is January 31st of 2020. And also some states exempt certain wages from state unemployment taxes that are still subject to FUTA taxes. And in those situations, those wages would not be eligible for the 5.4% credit. There's an example we have portrayed here on this slide, and it just demonstrates how wages taxed at the full FUTA rate of 6% would impact an employer with $1 million of wages. And it would really translate to an additional FUTA tax of about $54,000 for that amount. On this slide, we talk about the Virgin Islands again, and this comes from the Department of Labor's website. There's a link there if you wanted to see any additional information. The only important thing to remember, as Karen alluded to at the beginning, is that these numbers are tentative and not truly official until November 10th of 2019. That's when the official Department of Labor and IRS certifications come down about the credit reductions. And this shows a potential credit reduction for the Virgin Islands. On the next slide, we have a great picture, shows the status of state UI trust fund borrowing. And, of course, we only have Virgin Islands with $63 million. Keep in mind that at the peak of the Great Recession recovery, we had $40 billion of state borrowing for insolvent trust funds. This just gives you a really good picture about how we're improving and improving at a great extent. Now, this is a map that shows those states that aren't meeting the U.S. Department of Labor's solvency standard of 1.0. Basically, that's saying that the state trust fund has enough in its trust fund to pay 1 year's worth of benefits. Some of these states are really close to the 1.0, so I don't want to give an impression that these states are in danger of being insolvent. It just gives you an idea of about how states are in terms of their relative solvency. Some states make conscious decisions not to forward fund their trust funds, and this is just a portrayal of the situation as of today. And actually, this is as of January 1st of 2019, the most recent data available. And again, this is a great improvement over what we have seen in the past. And I think now, Karen, I wanted to turn it back to you and just have a brief polling question.
Yes, thank you so much, Tom, for all that good information we've been getting so far. So at this point, you should be seeing the second polling question on your screen. And our question is, how prepared are you to file 2019 FUTA taxes? Your options are you fully prepared? Are you somewhat prepared? Or are you not prepared? And I'm going to give my second CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And I'm going to give you all a few more seconds. If for some reason you're not seeing the polling question, please feel free to respond in the Q&A. Text field is fine, and we'll record it for you. Okay, Tom, you should be seeing the results on the screen.
Great. And thank you, Karen. So we're looking at, well, as expected, most people are fully prepared, and there are some that are somewhat prepared. Most are one of those two, which is a really great thing. And that time is fast approaching, so it would behoove you to become prepared, if not. All right, so let's move into a quick discussion of things happening in the world of state unemployment tax that would be noteworthy for the people on this call. I think that we'll start off with a discussion of California Assembly Bill 5. This codified for California workers the essential parts of the Dynamex decision, which was a court decision that addressed whether certain workers would be considered employees in California for services that had previously been treated as independent contractor work. Now, California employers are concerned about the retroactivity of AB 5, because it not only covers work performed on or after January 1st of 2020, but also retroactively if there are existing claims for coverage. The key point of AB 5 is the presumption of employment unless it is proven that all three conditions are satisfied. And we see here the conditions A, B, and C. This conjunctive ABC test could be applied to those working in the gig economy, such as Uber and Lyft drivers, TaskRabbit workers, et cetera. Now, where AB 5 applies, there are some that say up to 1 million workers would now be covered for workers' compensation, unemployment insurance and disability insurance, paid family and medical leave programs. Now, this is consequential for both employers and employees and will continue to be forcefully argued. And just as an example, a couple of weeks ago, Uber continued to assert publicly that it uses only independent third-party transportation providers. It sounds like they're not initially going to consider them as falling within AB 5. It's also worth noting that AB 5 exempted a large number of workers from the bill, and some of the examples are commercial fishermen, manicurists, insurance salespeople, physicians, dentists, lawyers, of course, architects, engineers, and accountants. So the consequences are really two. For gig economy advocates, those that really think this is a great thing to do and want to continue to promote it, they would consider this to be arbitrary and could force businesses to lay off workers to pay for new labor costs. While on the other hand, worker advocates would consider this bringing many hundreds of thousands of workers under employment protections. So the last thing just to mention here is that the California legislation has no direct effect on federal employment determinations, other than creating another difference, potentially, in coverage between state and federal employment law. So I think there's going to be more to come on this. It is a continuing to evolve situation. This next slide just highlights the significance of state paid family medical leave programs. They're springing up all over the country. For tax managers, paying attention to these programs is important because they all all seem to have rules or implementations that are unique to the state. And I listed the different approaches that states are using for their implementation. You can see that some are relying on existing wage reporting, some to UI, some to the revenue agencies, some are employer paid, some are employee paid, and some are both. So it's just worth noting these are really important programs coming up. They have consequences for your tax situation, and you need to be mindful of states in which they are coming up. This is a quick mention of heightened awareness for reporting wages with missing or impossible Social Security numbers. States are continuing to begin to reject employer quarterly wage reports for SSNers. And the reason I mention this is it has consequences for states with the new systems that automatically calculate employer taxes from wage items reported and accepted by the state system. Obviously, when they're rejected, they're excluded from the tax computation process and require follow-up. So this is just another area that needs to have some renewed focus. This is the last slide I really want to talk about, and it is to remind everybody of these. It's an effort to notify there's certain states are tightening authorization requirements and how those actions can adversely affect the ability of a third party to successfully file, pay, and administer client tax obligations. Hawaii is listed in that second column towards the end there. They are still planning later this year to reject filings and payments that would otherwise be fine for clients without authorizations. And the client slash employer is the one that has to initiate that authorization process. So that is something that everyone needs to be aware of. So just to wrap it all up, what we're looking for down the road, FUTA is in great shape. Unless you have VI, Virgin Islands employees, this would be a normal FUTA year that 6/10, 7,000, just as normal. We're looking for authorizations, trending. The bullet about Michigan unemployment, they're not alone. Indiana, Oregon, many states have triggers that trigger on either high wage bases and or higher tax rates for delinquencies. Be mindful of those states that have those triggers and make sure that they're taken care of. But in general, as this slide says, things are improving, and it's looking pretty positive for both federal and state unemployment in 2020. And John, I think our guru for the IRS is next, and it'd be my pleasure to turn you over to John Mott. Are you ready?
Thanks, Tom. Yes.
You're welcome.
All right. So now we'll take a little bit of time to look at changes to year-end reporting. As Pete indicated earlier, I have a pretty long history in the employment tax arena, 23 years in employment tax with IRS, and another 10 years now here at ADP. So want to share some key year-end information and trends that are happening at IRS. And as it's not too surprising, one of the big issues, of course, is and always will be the federal W-2, and the reason for that is largely around IRS's need these days to identify, prevent refund fraud issues. Refund fraud is a particularly troubling issue for IRS. Obviously, their goal is to get the right refund in the hand of the right taxpayer as quickly as possible each year. And in order to do that, and in order to prevent the refund fraud, what typically happens is you have fraudsters out there that are regularly filing returns, trying to file returns with fraudulent Social Security numbers, fraudulent wage data, as early as possible to beat the actual filer to the deadline and get a refund in hand before IRS receives a legitimate return and can identify the discrepancies. So over the last several years, we've seen a number of initiatives that affect the W-2. And The first of which many of you may have encountered through your service providers is the W-2 verification code pilot. And this was actually a pilot that lasted for 4 years worth of filing. It was piloted first in 2015, and it was really testing the capability of the process, and it expanded somewhat over those three years of the program. Where IRS was looking to see if having that key identifier on a W-2 that would help verify the authenticity of the data it contained was helpful in assisting them to manage the refund fraud issues with less impact to the individual taxpayers that were filing it. And I think what they found largely was that there was some significant success. But what really happened and what we see here in the second column, the pilot is now being officially discontinued for tax year 2019. So for those of you who may have been used to seeing the W-2 verification code on your W-2s for a number of years, that will no longer happen for 2019 W-2s. And largely the reason that was eliminated was that the earlier W-2 filing deadline that moved back to January 31st a few years back has now enabled IRS to get that data into its fraud detection systems at a much earlier time frame. And so they've found less need for this type of authentication to validate the actual forms in question. So, of course, IRS extends their thanks to any and all that participated in the pilot, and I know many employers were very happy to be part of those pilots because it really offered that extra level of security for their employees, and I think in many ways took some burden off of employers who might have otherwise been asked to verify data from the IRS directly. So if you're interested in any more information on the W-2 verification code program, even though it's no longer in place, if you're just curious what it was, there's a link at the bottom of the slide that will take you to that information on IRS.gov. So as we've discussed already, a large part of tax fraud and refund fraud happens really early in the tax filing season. So we're looking at January, February timeframe, where a fraudster is trying to get that return to process and a refund to be issued before the actual SSN's owner. And the other problem is that other legitimate taxpayers also file early and want to get their refund as quickly as possible as well. And so in order to help prevent that, what IRS has is a couple of programs in place. And they have proactive fraud and identity theft protection and additional fraud reviews that are going on. And they have what's known as the Electronic Fraud Detection System. And it actually uses models that IRS has developed over 20, 30 years of tax return filing with historical fraud indicators, things that might cause question as to whether the return was legitimate, whether it's based. And they don't reveal the specifics of all of their filters. But what they're looking for is anything that might indicate that there's a problem with a filing and that the refund contained therein is fraudulent in nature. Certainly helping to a great extent with that information now is the earlier availability of W-2 data. While it's certainly more of a burden to employers to file those W-2s by the end of January, it's far more beneficial and helpful to IRS to be able to have that data on hand when a return is filed to ensure that the withholding and the tax and the wage information that's being reported by the individual are truly what was represented in their W-2s. So basically IRS is looking at all of these factors, looking at conditions that could cause questions around the validity or authenticity of a refund. And if they make a determination that there's some data that might be in question, one of the avenues that they would follow is just frequently to reach out, and I'm sure it's happened to many on this call, to confirm the authenticity of the data from an individual W-2. So we'll move on to the next slide and talk a little bit about IRS's Return Integrity and Compliance Services Program. In the past, you might have received a request from IRS, similar to what I'm about to talk about. They're typically made either by phone or via fax, and employers may only have a few, or there may be employers that have many of these types of requests. And in many cases, it's largely due to the volume of employees in any given situation. But there, you know, IRS will evaluate that on a yearly basis, and if they see a trend that a particular employer may have a larger volume than usual, they'll often reach out to those employers ahead of year end, around this time in the year, and they'll be asking employers to share their W-2 data with them directly in order to assist in their fraud verification process. And so what they will do is they will reach out, make the request. They're going to ask for the data to be in a format. It's the same format that's filed with the SSA on the through their EFW-2 process. One thing of important note here for those clients that are using ADP or another service provider is that the authorization you sign and the authorization we work under as your service provider does not allow ADP to file that data directly, provide that data directly to the IRS. It authorizes us to use your data only for official filings, and official filings would be your W-2 filings to the SSA, your 941 or 940 filings to the IRS, but it doesn't authorize us to provide this extra data that they're requesting. So this is data that would have to be provided directly to the IRS by you from your files and your own records. Also an important note here, over to the right-hand side of the slide, just very important to note, the address provided is the only valid address to send this data to. Obviously, in this day and age, we see a number of instances where fraudsters are attempting to gain W-2 data through email scams and other types of criminal activity. Here we have the only address that IRS is going to, so if they're asking you to send it to any other address, it's highly likely that that request is fraudulent in nature. And if you do receive a request like that, IRS asks and urges that you forward any of those invalid requests to the email address below, that's phishing@irs.gov, to help in their processes and detecting who the fraudsters are out there today, because it changes on a daily, hourly basis even. So moving on to identity verification operations. As I mentioned earlier, IRS has their electronic fraud detection system, but they're also looking at other indicators that might indicate that beyond simple refund fraud, we might have a case of identity theft in process as well. And so they're looking at their dependent databases. They're looking at all of the other fraud indicators, and they're really looking to determine if they think that return might have been compromised. And they're looking for factors that they will not reveal what they are. But knowing this, and what's important to you as employers to understand is that IRS is looking at this, and they may be reaching out to your employees with these problems, and some of these problems could be related to W-2 filings. So IRS will contact those individuals, notifying them that they've identified some problem or issue that needs additional verification, and some of the letters that they would be sending are listed below the 4883C, 5071C, or 5447C, and ask them to validate their identity either via phone call or a letter back in response to those notices. And some of that, they may be coming to you as their employer to assist with that process, so just important that you're aware. These are the new types of authentications that IRS is doing to help protect identities and prevent fraud overall. So. Okay, moving on to a kind of annual issue, and that's just 2020 federal limits. You may have already seen SSA just a few weeks back released their updated Social Security earnings threshold for 2020, and that is now $137,700 for the maximum Social Security taxable wages. Social Security rate, of course, remains unchanged at 6.2%. And, of course, the Medicare threshold remains unlimited. And the estimated maximum employer and employee Social Security contribution, this is the maximum total contribution per employee, is now $17,074.80. Medicare rates all remain the same at 1.45%. And then we have those employees that are earning more than $200,000 that are still going to be subject to the additional Medicare supplement of 0.9% on wages in excess of $200,000. Just a quick look at some of the other security tools that IRS has available. They have provide verification tools that allow employers to monitor deposit activity if you're using a third-party provider. It's basically called an inquiry PIN through the EFTPS system, the Electronic Federal Tax Payment System, and it allows an employer to monitor the deposit activity that's being made on their behalf. It's certainly something that's prudent, even if you're using a trusted provider, to ensure that everything is going the way it's intended. So it's just something that's helpful to have that information and be able to know for certain that the deposits that are being made on your behalf are in fact being made. So it is recommended that employers do this on a regular basis. A couple of links provided over on the left for those that may be not familiar with the EFTPS system or the inquiry PIN process. You can get some more information at the links to the right-hand side. And Karen, it looks like it's time for our next polling question.
Yes, thank you so much, John. It is. So this is our third polling question of the session. You should be seeing it now. So at this point, our question is, what effects did the January 31st due date have on the number of W-2Cs you had to file for 2018? And your options are, you filed fewer than usual, you filed more than usual, or you filed about the same with no significant increase or decrease. Let me give my third CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'll give you all about five more seconds. Okay, John, at this point you should be, wait one second. Jump back on me. At this point, you should be seeing the results on the screen.
All right. Thanks, Karen. And, it's interesting, and it's kind of supporting information I'm hearing from Social Security, that it really hasn't had a significant increase. That was a fear when the date was changed, but it's good to see that many of you see about the same number of W-2Cs as you were prior to the new due date. So that's great to know. All right, just moving on. Little quickly talk about Social Security Administration and their new educational notices. Many may have already received them, and it will continue into for 2019 W-2s. They just recently resumed mailing their informational notices when W-2s are filed that contain SSN or name mismatches. Right about now, October and into early November, SSA is going to start mailing notices for paper-filed W-2s. So anyone who might have filed some paper W-2s could be seeing notices now if they had SSN name mismatches. Important factor to consider here is that although IRS traditionally has not assessed penalties in this arena on a regular basis, certainly now with this new focus on refund fraud and identity protection, it's viewed as pretty likely that this is something that IRS could be looking more to enforcing in the future. The code is there. The law is in place. IRS has the authority to enforce it. They just have chosen not to in most cases. So it's something that you want to keep your eyes on for the future, and certainly take those notices as seriously as you can. IRSSA will again begin issuing those notices again for 2019 W-2s sometime shortly. They haven't given dates yet, but likely in the February, early March timeframe for W-2s filed for 2019. Any, if you're looking for additional details and information on how to resolve those issues, the link's at the bottom of this slide. So what to look out for? IRS and their refund fraud information, validation requests that they'll be sending or asking you for additional information. Be on the lookout, obviously, for any fraudulent requests for copies of your employees' wage and income data. Any abuse, any possible fraudulent activity you identify, please report it to the IRS, phishing@irs.gov. In the W-2, W-2C, just be waiting for those notices. It's unusual not to have at least a few SSNs names that might mismatch at the end of the year, so it's likely many will see them. Use the SSA tools to resolve them and really just be proactive about validating employee name and SSN data through the tools that SSA makes available, Social Security Number Verification Service, as well as losing my place here, well as through the I'm blanking on the system. E-Verify, excuse me, so sorry. I wasn't following my notes. So anyway, E-Verify and SSNVS to help verify that in advance. And then that should set you well for minimizing the effects of those notices. And now I'll hand it to my colleague, Charles Collins. Charles?
Thanks, John. I also want to welcome all of you to our session today. I hope the information is helpful for you. Like the other speakers, I have many years in tax administration compliance, mine with the state and the North Carolina Department of Revenue for many years, and also about 15 years with ADP, currently serving as one of the directors in government affairs. I want to talk to you today about a few things in the state tax arena. If I can get the slides to move here. Yep. So we'll talk about some state withholding issues and changes. Pete and John have gone over a few of these because some of the state changes relate to things that are happening at the federal level. The states are continuing to work in their efforts to reduce refund fraud and improve compliance. Mainly those efforts are in two general areas, validating the tax claimed. As John mentioned earlier, fraudsters try to get a fraudulent return in early. So states have tried to take action to reduce and mitigate that risk. We talked before about moving the W-2 reporting dates up earlier to January 31st. That's where most all states are now. We did notice recently that Iowa had moved their date to February the 15th. That's a little bit of an outlier there. States are increasing the W-2s being filed electronically. I think many of them are going to that now. They can get the data in-house, loaded into their data warehouses and their systems, and be able to match off what individuals claim on their returns much better. Another way they're looking at reducing their risk here is trying to weed out and check those invalid W-2 submissions. Now they're matching the number of W-2s filed with the annual reconciliation count of how many are included. And also we're seeing a few states that are separating and having the requirement of submitting W-2s separate from 1099s. They're given the different account numbers to people for doing that. That may be something that we look for and see in the future. At the end of the day, what this amounts to is increased matching of third-party sources to be sure they've got the information correctly. Also, we have a number of states now beginning to increased penalties for late filing of W-2s. All in all, it's just using more data and making better use of the available data. On the issue of mobile workers, that continues to be a matter that we're following. Employees traveling outside their state of residence for a business purpose or their work. In many instances, this has varying compliance in those new states, and it's become an issue that's having greater attention by states as they look at those workers that are there for the purpose of taxing. There's not a lot of consistency in how some of the states can view mobile workers, so there has been some efforts in place to try to consolidate that and have more clarity as to how these workers should be taxed. We've had a number of bills introduced on the House side in Congress. We've had a bill that has passed the House, but to this point, nothing has passed the Senate. However, earlier this year, we did have Senate Bill 604 that was introduced in the Senate with over 35 co-sponsors. We need to continue to keep following that to see if we get any action or movement in that particular area there. This bill would provide some uniformity in the way these workers are taxed. Karen, let me turn it back over to you now for, I believe, our last polling question.
Yes, thank you so much, Charles. So at this point, you should be seeing the last polling question on the screen. And our question is, have you been audited for employees working temporarily out of state? As Charles is saying, that can be a bit of an issue. So your possible responses is a very easy one. Yes, you have been. No, you have not. Or you are unsure. I'm going to give my last CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit to make sure you respond to the question. I'll give you just a couple more seconds. Such an easy one. Okay, Charles, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Okay. Perhaps not unexpected that a lot of people have not been audited for it. I believe this is an issue where if you're an employer and you have this issue, it's a major issue. If you don't have employers working out of state, obviously it's not one that you're following yet. Let's look briefly at what we might see or what might be things to look for in the future. As we mentioned earlier, I think more agencies will be comparing their income tax filings and the W-2 filings to be sure that is correct and before they issue refunds. We'll see more states, I believe, that will delay refunds, be sure that data is correct, question it. If there's anything there that looks strange, I think they'll be sending more letters to individual taxpayers to try to validate that this is their return before they move forward. Most states have put new systems in place already to improve their processing, but a few other ones are putting those in place and doing some updating. More looking at different ways to prevent fraud as they come available. And as we mentioned earlier, more penalties for late filing. I think now I'm going to turn it over to Pete to do a little bit more, maybe in the ACA area. Pete?
All right. Thanks, Charles. That's very key information you just went over, so thanks for that. On the Affordable Care Act, really, we're going to talk about state variations at this point. Why is that? It's what happened in December 2017 was the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. One of the things that it did was to effectively repeal, but can't, you know, changing the penalty amount to zero, the individual mandate, which many thought to be a very key element of the Affordable Care Act. And so, not surprisingly, pretty much immediately after that, we saw at least 11 states take legislative action to enact effectively an individual mandate, a health coverage mandate in the state, which, you know, that's not, I mean, we sort of expected that these are 11 states. Is it going to be 20, 26? I mean, how many states are going to do this is one interesting question. But in terms of, just what to expect, to have 11 states formulate legislation as quickly as they did is kind of a speed of light response. So I do expect other states to follow. Anyway, this is this list of the states that have made efforts, those in bold actually enacted a law, and a couple of them have employer reporting requirements attached to them. So I'll go over those in a little bit of detail. And the question is, you know, if there's an individual mandate required that, you know, people in these states have maintained health coverage, how does the state tax authority, because typically the penalty is administered by the tax authority, how does the tax authority enforce that? The answer is they pretty much will need employers and insurers to report to the state, similar to how employers and insurers report to the IRS. So Massachusetts actually was the, you know, the initial model for the Affordable Care Act, and they had a mandate many years ago. They basically reenacted, and so not much of a change there. The Massachusetts employers are you know, kind of used to doing that. In contrast, though, New Jersey, D.C., these laws are in effect this year, which I've been surprised we haven't seen more press on that, because, you know, there's actually a reporting requirement covering 2019 in New Jersey and the District of Columbia. And, you know, they're fairly broad. but, you know, I should say, you know, all of these states that I'll talk about, they took the same perspective, which is that let's make this as easy as possible for employers, and let's just require the same information that's currently reported to the IRS, which is a great approach, except it's not that easy. So think about it. You know, take New Jersey, take D.C. But what are the exceptions? For one thing, you're probably not going to want to send the state of New Jersey, if you're a multi-state employer, you would only want to send them the correct, you know, the employees that you're supposed to, that are New Jersey residents or New Jersey taxpayers, New Jersey workers, that kind of thing. So there's going to be probably an effort to narrow down and define, you know, well, which employees should I be reporting to New Jersey, which employees should I be reporting to D.C., and there are specific definitions associated with that. There's also the question, and Charles just touched on this, which, you know, which is what about people who are part-year residents or part-year taxpayers, or they work in New Jersey or D.C. for part of the year? And as Charles mentioned, the thresholds for, you know, at what point, you know, 30 days, 14 days, at what point does somebody working in a state actually become a taxpayer, become responsible and liable, and when does the employer become responsible for withholding and reporting? Those thresholds vary considerably from state to state, so that's a separate question that you have to figure out, you know, because you're not going to be sending, you know, your full, all employees in every state to New Jersey and every employee, no matter which state, to D.C. and so forth. So you're probably going to be selective about that. Here is another couple of states, and California is a huge one to pick this up. But this begins in January 2020, so there's a little more lead time to prepare for this. Vermont is up there, and, you know, their law has been in place, but they did specify that no employer reporting is going to be required at this point. It would, so that's not going to have a direct impact. But in California, we've talked to the Franchise Tax Board many times, and the part of the what's going to be new about this is that the Franchise Tax Board has never administered any direct reporting from employers before. It's all gone to the Employment Development Department. So from the employer's perspective, they're dealing with an entirely new tax agency and tax reporting requirement. So that's a pretty significant issue. And anyway, they're working on rulemaking, things like that. We haven't seen too many specifications from these states. And Rhode Island, similarly, we've worked a little bit with the tax authority there to raise these questions of what do you do about, you know, part-year residents, and what exactly is the definition of a person that needs to be reported? What about dependents? What if the employer's out of state? What if the employee's out of state? What if the dependent's in state but the employee's out of state? You know, lots of permutations along those lines. There's another set of exceptions where it's not going to be as easy as just send us whatever you sent to the IRS. Why is that? You know, for one thing, you know, the states are not going to replicate the IRS AIR system. The XML-oriented electronic filing system is a very sophisticated system. There's no way that most states are going to be able to replicate that. So really, it's a state-by-state question of, okay, so how exactly am I going to send this information to you? And a lot of states are looking at, well, you know, you're already sending us W-2 information electronically, so let's just use that regime and you know, follow that. There's another question of formats. So whatever you send to IRS, it's in a nicely formatted XML file, subject to a certain, you know, series of editing requirements, things like that. And again, there's no way that many states are going to be able to replicate that. So a lot of work over the next year or so to figure out exactly what these states are going to require. And again, we're probably going to see some other states pop up. So yeah, we're concerned long-term with, you know, if we, a couple of years down the road, if we end up with 26 or so states with a similar but, you know, diverse reporting requirements related to the Affordable Care Act and the individual mandate, could be tougher than the ACA was initially. So just to wrap up, you know, we're looking at, you know, what did the tax bill do to the Affordable Care Act? What are the states going to be doing? We're still expecting some guidance from the IRS on a number of factors in other states. So, and as John mentioned, we're, you know, enforcement of the Form 75C and W-2 accuracy requirements is still kind of out there, and at some point the IRS is going to start enforcing that as well. So, I think with that, we're pretty much out of time. So let me turn it back over to Karen to wrap up.
Thank you so much, Pete. Yeah, so unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you ask to receive CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. I did want to mention very briefly, since we did get a lot of questions on the W-4, that we at ADP are working on a digital toolkit that will be available to everyone that includes screenshots explaining the W-4, as Pete did today, including a sample communication you can use for employees. And we will be sending that out as a separate communication to this group next week. And on behalf of all our speakers today, myself and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future events on our changing regulatory landscape. Thank you and have a great rest of your day.